next hour and a half is to take you literally from A to Z in terms of prop making, from design to completion and storage. If you guys have any questions during the presentation, just raise your hand. We'll call on you, and then you can go ahead and ask your question. First, let's go ahead and introduce ourselves. A little bit about us. My name is Amber Reynolds. Sometimes I go by Cospod Amber, as I run a podcast called Cospod. I have been sewing and cosplaying since I was 16. I have been doing it for 14 years. You do the math as how old I am, because it is rude to ask my own age. I just recently started prop making within the last 5 years. I take great joy in it, and I take even greater joy in teaching you guys how to do this sort of thing so that you can learn from my mistakes, because I do have a reputation for lighting things on fire and breaking things. I'm not teaching you how to do that today. Now, I would like to say that we do have a table of materials here on the side. If you are curious and wish to handle any of them, you're welcome to come up at any time during the panel. Just please be quiet and have a look at them. You're welcome to take pictures as needed, write anything down. This is for your learning enjoyment. So with that, I will turn it over to Steve. Okay. Raise your hand if you want to
add. Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Steve Leptak. I'm a retired airline pilot. My wife and I have been doing costuming and fabrication of props for about 30 years, so before some of you were born, I guess. We've been in steampunk the last few years. We work in metal, plastic, wood. My forte is electronics, particularly digital theory, lighting systems, and that'll be my part of the panel today. It'll be all the different ways that you can enhance and do lighting effects in props and costumes.
My name's Lane. I've been doing resin casting for about 20 years or so. Just recently got into cosplay type stuff. Most of my work's been really small scale, which really encourages you to perfect your technique, because a little tiny bone will ruin a part. What you're going to be doing, you can make mistakes. But just give it a try.
A lot of these things are important. How the heck are you going to transport your props? Has anybody else tried to move a 7-foot sword? You know how well it fits in your car? May I say, not at all. I move 6 and 7 foot staffs for Renaissance festivals often. Folding down the seats is not always an option, especially if you have passengers. So you have to figure out, how are you going to get it to the convention? Something that you may consider is making your staff or your prop modular, which simply means it comes apart. This is a lot easier to fit in a car than this is, right? Plus, if something breaks, it's a lot easier to fix it by only having to fix one piece of your prop. This was done simply by using PVC pipe that I cut in half and a dowel rod. This is nothing more than masking tape and duct tape. That's it. And I just slide them together, and then you get a staff. Next consideration to have is storage. Once you're done with the con, how many of you are considering throwing away your prop? No. I didn't think so. You spent all that time on that prop, right? You don't just want to throw it out. You have to keep it somewhere. And for those of you still living at home, mom and dad may have something to say about where you put your props. If you have pets, your pets will definitely have something to say on where you put your props. And if you have small children, definitely consideration on where you put your props, because you don't want them damaged. And so if you have large props like this, well, yes, we wish to start small children off with cosplay early. Starting them with props may not be the best way of doing that, especially if they have other younger siblings, because, you know, they're going to start beating their siblings with the props first. Durability test is a good thing, not that way. So you have to figure out, where are you going to put these? In your closet, hanging on your wall as a nice trophy. You can store them in a corner if you have a spare corner in your house, although if you're like me and a cosplayer, there are no free spaces in your house. And then you have to think about where will you put them in costume? Are you going to just carry around your prop the whole time? Your arms do get tired, I promise you. Mm-hmm. I've been carrying this around all day. So for those who have swords, daggers, shields, anything like that, you can build scabbards to hold your props so that you can have free hands for doing, say, other poses for your cosplay, or if you wish to, say, go in the dealer's den and handle your favorite manga. So that is something else to think about. Where will you put your props while you're in costume? There's not always a good place to set them down against the wall, you know? Is this a convention-approved prop? This is Project Akon. How many of you guys have dealt with weapons check already? A few. You know that there are rules for what sorts of materials you can use to build weapons. They're not going to let you bring in a metal sword. Please do not try it. Con Patrol does not tend to take jokes lightly. That way. So it is wise to check their website first to see if they will allow it. In fact, this is made out of foam board, which is the little nice tripod material kids use for science fair projects. They almost did not let me have this because it was too hard. So do look at the materials, because you don't want to put all your effort into your prop and then not be able to bring it and have to leave it in your car or your hotel room. And then last but not least, does your prop need to be stage ready? Are you actually going to fight people with it? No, this is not a suggestion or a requirement. But if you are going to be doing, say, a skit, you may wish to have a prop that can actually take some damage. This one is actually already broken twice. This is not stage ready. Stage ready simply means that you need to give it a hard core. What I would recommend for giving cores to props are dowels. All you need to do is you cut out the shape of your prop, either in foam or whatever material you're going to have. Cut out a small rectangle as a channel, stick the dowel right there, and then you make a sandwich with it. Make sense? That is the easiest way to do it, and the most calm legal way of doing it. Shellacking is not calm legal. Alright, so once you've gotten past your considerations, now we get the fun part. Now we get all the materials that you can use in making props, which is pretty much anything, right? You can use pretty much, I cannot think of a single thing that you cannot use besides food to make a prop. Actually, no, food can be props. If you cosplay from Wreck-It Ralph, food can be used as props.
It works for Lady Gaga.
That is true. That is true. And that is cosplay.
Probably won't last all day, though.
That's one of those considerations where you store it. Pets are a very important consideration. All right, so we have the usual cardboard, foam board, poster board. These are the ones that most people think about when you're making props. There are a couple things to think about in terms of your materials, and that's durability and flexibility. How many people here are gamers? Holy cow. All right, so you guys will understand when I say things like constitution and fortitude, or dexterity and reflex, right?
Yes.
So you have flexibility and durability on two different ends of the spectrum. Can you have both? Not really. You go on that spectrum and you put your points in whichever one you want more of. So that's something to consider with your materials. These particular three are not very durable. They are extremely flexible, which is a good thing for Con Patrol, because then they will say, how far does it bend? And you can say, this far. And you can prove that you won't hurt anybody. That repeated itself for some reason. All of the foam family. Insulation foam, which is the pink stuff you use to insulate houses. You can buy it at Home Depot and Lowe's. Please do not inhale it. It is not cotton candy. No, I don't speak from experience. Does anybody not know what EVA foam is, or EVA foam? Okay, there's a couple people in the room. EVA foam, which we will actually be talking more about when I do my armoring panel on Sunday, if you've ever seen those little yoga mats, or the little kids' crafting mats, little puzzle-looking pieces, they sell them in groups of four, all sorts of wacky colors. That is EVA foam. It's basically an industrial version of craft foam. The only difference is its structure, which is a little bit thicker and sturdier, slightly less flexible, and it does have a hatched pattern on one side that you may not want to show on the outside unless you want a really cool halo armor effect. So that is EVA foam. Expanding foam. Expanding foam works something like Cheese Whiz in that it comes out of a little container and you literally spray it like foam or shaving cream. And it expands to several times what you think you put down on there. So I would recommend small doses, as much as you want to do the whole thing, small doses. And then you carve it away, either with a paring knife, with an electric knife, with a hot foam cutter, any number of things. It's very tough stuff, but it's very cool. It's about $12 a can. So that gives you an idea of how expensive it is. You can probably make one full prop with one full can, a large prop. A lot of people also use it for armor making, incidentally. Then you have fun foam. Has anybody not played with fun foam? Okay, a couple people. Craft foam is something that you can find in most hobby stores, including Target, Hobby Lobby, and Michaels. It comes in several thicknesses. You can get it as thin as 2 millimeters. You can get it as thick as 6 millimeters. It's very flexible. You can layer it if you want it to be more sturdy. Very paintable. Basically, there are no disadvantages to craft foam. It's also extra cheap on sale. You can get it in rolls of up to, I think, 6 feet. 6 feet by 3 feet. If you want to make armor with them, they do sell larger kinds. Yes?
Which would you say is the easiest foam to cut and carve?
Of those? Mm-hmm. Craft foam, by far.
Craft foam.
Okay. Yes. The more flexible a material is, the easier it is to cut. Insulation foam, not very easy to cut. Yes?
EVE, doesn't it stand for ethyl vinyl acetate?
I believe so.
Yes, it is.
That's the same polymer found at the bottom of sneakers.
Yes. They manufacture it slightly differently. But it is basically chemically the same material. Although I would not recommend using the bottom of sneakers to make problems. Just say.
How do you get your hands on it though? Where do you find that?
You find it at Lowe's, Home Depot, or Harbor Freight. It is normally $15 for a pack of four. If you get it on sale, it is $7.50. Yes, sir?
Recently, I've had more success with the L300.
Okay.
Which you can buy in really big sheets online.
Yes.
It sometimes helps in making big armor pieces.
Yes. And there are some lovely suppliers and manufacturers of foam rolls. You can literally buy it by the roll. You can even get rolls at Joann's, oddly enough. You can get, they call it chair padding or upholstery foam. But you can get similar stuff at Joann's. And then, of course, resin, everybody's favorite, which Lane will be presenting on a little bit later with casting. Yes?
They were using the stuff on Face-Off,
I
think it was L200.
L200. L200. They were heating that up. Is that just a standard heat gun?
Yes.
Is that the heat gun that you use just for every other project?
Yes.
So if I just buy a regular heat gun, I don't have to have anything other special?
Correct.
So
it's helpful to pay attention on these. These have certain temperature ranges. Foam takes different temperatures when you heat it up. Otherwise, you will either roast it or you will light it on fire. No, do not light it on fire. That is not a recommendation. Do as I say, not as I do. But yes, usually that sort of foam takes somewhere between 165 and 180 degrees Fahrenheit to shape. Any hotter than that, your foam will start to sag and it will start to char, and that is a sign that your heat gun is too hot. Please turn it down just slightly. We're not trying to bake foam. You will smell it, by the way. If you roast your foam, your house will smell for days.
So you recommend doing it outside?
Yes, please. Also, cutting foam with a hot cutter does release toxic fumes. Please do it with ventilation. Outside is preferable. Inside one's apartment with windows closed is not. Please do it safely. And if you need to, you can always wear a respirator, which I do not have with me. It's one of those awesome masks that you sometimes see in the old movies that have the filters on the side. That is a respirator. You can use those to help if you have foam particulate that you are working with so you don't inhale it into your lungs, because that's unpleasant. How are we about to? Okay, 15 minutes. All right, plaster, clay, paper mache. These are probably the cheapest materials you can use to make props. They're also one of the most versatile. I do have some plaster over here if anybody would like to take a look. It's very similar to paper mache. Mix with water, pour it. It will look like pudding. Do not eat it. You have to wait until it cures before you touch it or you will dent it. If anybody's ever walked on a wet sidewalk and seen the imprints, it does that. Once it is done, then you can remove your cast and then you'll have a mold, which again, Lane will be covering a little bit later. Something to mention about clay, there are two types of clay. You get the oven-baked kind and you get the air-dry kind. If you are going to oven bake it, please bear in mind that your oven is going to smell, and if you try and bake food in it, your food may also smell. So you may not wish to do it in the same oven with which you bake food, unless you're planning on cleaning it.
What about
Easy Bake
Oven?
Easy Bake Oven. I have not tried that. Now I'm curious, and I may have to go to the dollar store and get one so I can. All in the name of science, you understand. Totally in the name of science.
A cheap toaster oven.
Yes. Toaster oven is also a wonderful way to go. See, you guys are giving me ideas. This is not good. All right, an old repurposed toys and jewelry, which Steve will actually be covering a little bit later. You can actually take apart toys. It is okay to take apart toys to use them for other things. And you can literally go to the dollar store and just pick up handfuls of toys and then take them apart. Yes, science. You name it, you can probably use it. Yes. He blinded me with science, by the way. I can actually send, I'll have this on our website if it helps.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, for anybody who wants this PowerPoint later, I will give you our website address. This, all of these guys' handouts, everything we do here, including the video, will be on our website within a week.
Great.
So don't worry, if you miss something, don't worry, there will be copies.
Yeah.
All right. Dimensions of your prop is a very important thing. It does not help to have a 12-foot sword if you're only 5 feet tall. When I originally made this, it was actually 2 feet taller than this.
Wow.
Think how hard transporting that would have been. And in fact, I ended up having to hold it up to myself and to my reference picture, and I had to lop off 2 feet because it wasn't proportionate to me, and it made it hard to handle, which is part of the proportion thing. It's not just so it looks right, but it's also so you can actually handle it, pose with it, transport it, and maintain it. For those who are coming in, we do have handouts here at the front. Please grab one if you are interested. And there's a couple different ways of making your prop proportional to you. You can either measure your reference picture and then measure yourself and do math. Yes, there is a use for math in life. This is one of those, when am I ever gonna use this in school? Now. For cosplay. You can also do a guesstimate, which is an educated estimate of how large it looks compared to your character, and then how large it should be on you, give or take, you know, a few inches. Sketch out the design lightly. You will make changes. You're welcome to sketch out in pen, but it's going to be very hard to see the final form of your prop design later on after you've made about 10 different changes to it. For that, I do speak from experience. I always have to cross out all my extra lines whenever I make mistakes. So I do urge you to sketch it out in pencil. I also urge you to sketch it out full size. If you need to get butcher paper, please do. It is cheap. You can buy it at the store. You can also buy it at postal service as butcher paper. So I do, that way you can also see proportion. So I do recommend that, sketch it out full size. Notate where everything's going to go. You don't want to finish your prop and then figure out that your really awesome LEDs have nowhere to go. Same goes for battery packs. If you have something that lights up, makes noise, or needs power to move, you're going to need a battery pack somewhere unless you have found the way of free, completely wireless energy. And if you do, let me know, because I have a patent that I would like to sign with you. You will need a place to put those sorts of things, so you do need to decide where are seams going to go, where are joints going to go. If your prop needs to fold or be modular, where is it going to break? In half, in thirds, in quarters? If it needs to fold, if you have, say, a bow, the bow that you need to shoot, you can make bows fold in half for transport. If you make the bow in halves, one half, and you use a door hinge in the middle, one that has a locking deadbolt, that will hold it straight, and then you can wrap it in ribbon whenever you're ready to use it for photo shoots. Take off the ribbon, undo the bolt, fold it down for transport. But you have to mark that on your design so that you know, as you're constructing it, this is what the end result will be. Basically, you're looking to the future.
Welcome to the world of tomorrow.
Yes, welcome to the world of tomorrow. I love you guys. Make a life-size mock-up to test fit it. You will want to know how large this actually is on you after you're finished, because design does not necessarily equal results in real life. I promise this. It looks great on paper, that's what they always say, right? And it usually does. And then you make it, and you're like, wait a second, it doesn't look anything like I designed it. What happened? Cosplay elves. Then after you have finalized your design, you are happy with it, then you get to make the prop. Then you get to do all the awesome experimentation stuff in the name of science and cosplay. All right, what you'll want to do is start with the frame and core of the prop. This gives it strength. If you do not have a frame and core, your prop is very promptly going to collapse inward. So you want to give it some sort of structure. Just like you wouldn't drive a car that didn't have a frame, right? If you have a car with a damaged frame, it has to be repaired or your car's not safe. Same thing with a prop. It has to have a good, strong structure or it's going to collapse on you. It's going to be unsafe. For frames, you can use mesh. You can also use chicken wire, oddly enough, which you do not have to go to a farmer's market to get. You can get it at Home Depot. Build up around the frame, keeping safety requirements in mind. Again, cons don't allow shellac. A lot of them are frowning on fiberglass right now. Some of them are actually even frowning on airsoft as a frame, simply because people have done dumb things with them. There will always be dumb things done with props in the world, and we have to deal with it. That's simply the reality of it. So keep con safety requirements in mind. Example, Acon, if you push on the point of your prop, it has to have a half inch give. That's something that you need to consider when building the frame. Whenever you build around it, you're gonna have to have a half inch give, so you need to design that.
You can't do the lift anymore.
I don't know that they allow it anymore.
No,
they
don't.
I believe so. They do have age requirements as well, I think, for some. Which, it makes me very sad as a prop maker. We want to build cool stuff and bring it to cons, right? All right. As soon as you are done building up your frame, your core, everything that you need that is the base of your prop, then you get to start placing your casings and holes. If you have to drill into your prop, please drill pilot holes first. Pilot holes are small holes that you use to start the actual hole. It's like a test hole. It's a practice hole. The reason you don't just directly drill into it is it will crack. And it will crack hard, and your prop will fall into it. And then you get to make friends with adhesives.
Or if you're using a bigger tip that you want to use, and you're on top of the hole where you want your hole, mm-hmm. if you hit your drill mm-hmm. and it moves over, then you've made the hole off where you intended it to be.
Yes, and it is very easy to drill off where you planned it to be. Lasers are awesome things. Not for destruction, for helping you drill holes.
I don't know, I can ruin some material with a laser.
Be safe with lasers, kids. Remember, sharks with lasers.
Yay.
Sand, and sand some more. For those who have done casting and prop making, this is the bane of your existence. You are going to hate yourself after the end of sanding, because when you think you've done enough, but wait! There's more! You will have to sand until you think you cannot sand anymore, and then you'll have to take a break, and then you'll have to sand a little bit more. Lather, rinse, repeat. Because sanding is the basis for a good paint job. If you don't have a smooth surface, you're going to see it. And in fact, I have gesso over there. Gesso is a primer. If you think you have sanded enough, paint primer over it. You'll see if you sanded enough real quick. If it doesn't look right to you, sand some more, prime, look at it. Test it. Question?
Is a larger piece, can you use a ball sander?
Yes, you can. You can actually use several types of sanders. You can use orbital, palm sanders, you can use belt sanders. You can use pretty much any kind of sander you'd like to get your hands on and that you have the budget for. Which, how many of you guys have bought power tools recently? They're not cheap, right?
No. Almost Father's Day, so we'll
it's almost Father's Day. They're going to go on sale. Quick! Oh yeah, I'm buying this for my dad. Sure. No. It's worth the investment in power tools. If you're going to make props for a long time, it's worth it to get good tools. Don't settle for the bad tools, they will break. and then you will have to replace them with more expensive tools, and then you've wasted the money that you spent first off. So you may as well just like going to conventions that you want to go to, save up, get lots of money, then go get the stuff you want. All right, and then we have painting, weathering, and sealing. A good paint job depends on a good surface to start with. This doesn't even take priming into account. If you don't have a smooth surface, nothing is going to look good on it. And I'm sure some of you guys have seen armor and props where it was not sanded, where it looked very raw. If that's the look you want, that's okay. But if that's not what you're going for, you need to sand it down. How many of you guys know what grit is when dealing with sandpaper? Okay, quite a few of you. For those who do not know, grit is a rating of how coarse sandpaper is. Low grit, something like 60 or 80, is very coarse. It's going to be very, very scratchy. Start with that. Work your way up with higher numbers. You'll start to hit 200, 400, all the way up to even 2 and 4,000. That's very, very, very fine. That's automotive grade grit. That's something that they used to sand cars down with before they paint them. So you'll probably want to get several sets of sandpaper. Start low, work all the way up to high. Then you'll be much happier with yourself. It is a lot of work, but it turns out fantastic.
Very good marble.
Yes, very, very good point. It's going to take you longer than 5 minutes. Unless you have a TARDIS, then it might take you 5 minutes. And if you have one, again, calm. Well, if you have a TARDIS, I think there's going to be several hundred other cosplayers that want to get a hold of you, especially before con. Also helps to have a good primer. Primer is what you start with. It primes, not to use dictionary definition. It basically readies your surface for paint. Similar to how you, when you put on makeup, you have foundation or primer. Same idea. You put it on first, then you have the paint. It gives something for the paint to stick to, especially if you're using a very smooth, glossy surface. You don't have to use primer. It does help. It's one of those, you can do it. For metallic paint jobs, that should be two words, by the way. I'm sorry, grammar is not my strength. Consider layering colors underneath. Metal is not actually one flat color. If you look at metal armor, it's actually a couple of different colors. So if you're looking for a metallic paint job, which I've seen a lot on forums, they're like, how do you get armor to look metallic? Put a flat base of black or dark paint underneath it first. Then put down your metallic spray paint, sand it away. And then you'll get the mottled look that actual steel and metal have. And you can always layer. You can do, matte black, metallic, matte black, metallic. So that when you sand it away, not only do you get the metallic look, you get a weathered look, which makes it look beaten and battle damaged, which can look really cool. Yes?
I just found this out 2 days ago when I was making armor. Mm-hmm. Rust-Oleum has this amazing spray paint called Hammer.
Yes.
Horrible on every appliance.
Yes.
Because it makes it alien paint. But on this armor I was making, it made it look like the paint job that took 5 days. 5 minutes. It looked like this hammer. It made it look perfect armor.
For those who didn't hear, she mentioned it's Rust-Oleum is a brand of spray paint.
Yeah.
They actually have a specific paint called hammered metal that gives it a hammered look. I do have a couple paints over here. Specifically, I have Krylon. A lot of these places now have metallic lines. They have entire lines of just metallic paint. There's not one kind of gold, by the way. There's about six. There's about three different kinds of silver. So you may wish to experiment. Get the small cans, half this size. Experiment with those first. Then go ahead and get up to the big guys. You can also, if you want to do the matte spray paint, you can just use flat black spray paint if you want to layer underneath. It doesn't have to be acrylic. Yes.
Would you say using the metallic spray paint is better or going with the layer idea?
It depends on how realistic or futuristic you want it to look. If you do flat metal, in fact, I will very, very carefully pass this around. Modular. I did metallic paint only on the blade of this, and I will let you guys have a look. Also, this flat metallic paint. This way you can see how it looks compared to the laser. This is just flat. If you have it layered, it looks a little bit more like stainless steel. So it did, yes, the it looks more like your lamps. Everybody look at the lamp in front of you, that's how it looks. You can also purposely battle damage items, which basically means you throw them downstairs or wear them to the beach. Or gently take a hammer to them. Gently take a hammer to them. So that you don't break them. You want to damage them, you don't want to break them. Sealing. You get two choices, you get matte or gloss. How shiny do you want it to be? How reflective do you want it to be in photos? Generally, most people will probably want a matte job. If you want a shiny job, you can do that. And in fact, some of the metallic paint naturally has a gloss finish. But it's also very, very, very shiny. Lens glare shiny. All right, and this is casting. So let me switch over to the casting presentation. If I'm only concerned with it looking slightly beaten, spray paint. Just you'll have more control with an airbrush. Because spray paint tends to collect in places, and it's not even. Airbrushes are even. Go ahead.
All right, resin casting. Why would you want to do resin casting? Obviously, save money is probably the least of it. Because your materials are going to cost $30 to $50 a quart. But say you have a detail piece that you need six of. It's only found on a specific toy that hasn't been made in like 10 years. You could spend $200, $300 on eBay to get enough of that toy to get that one little piece. Make a mold. And for a few dollars, you're going to be able to copy those pieces. Sometimes your materials are expensive, whatever you made the original out of. Or you're making multiples. Like, say you've got a group doing an Attack on Titan cosplay. Yeah. Imagine people doing Attack on Titan. You could cast up for probably about $50 all of the gear, whereas buying individual materials is gonna just take a lot of your time, which is for most of us money. Again, saving time. If you spend 6 hours making one piece of your costume, and you need two or three of them, or again, as a group, you can save probably 3/4 of your time. If it takes 6 hours to make the original, it takes an hour to make your mold and half an hour to cast. You've just saved an entire day, which for most of us,
is a lot.
That means the difference between getting it done in time for the con or working on it at the con.
Yeah.
I'm going to pass around a resin cap so you guys can see this. This is a chest jacket.
Right. And changing materials. Sometimes your materials that are easy to work with or what you have available just aren't kind of appropriate. Like, this piece was easy for me to machine. There's no way they're going to let me put this on the end of a 6-foot staff and carry it around.
Con safety restrictions.
So, I can cast this piece out of resin. They might still say it's too hard, but they also make resin foams, both rigid and flexible foams. So if I wanted to, I can make basically a foam rubber end piece for that staff or foam rubber blade. Also, sometimes your original is too flimsy. Say you've got a large gem. You don't want to use glass. First of all, they won't let you. It's going to be hard to, you could carve it out of a solid block of acrylic, but that's going to be really expensive and time consuming.
You could use Christmas ornaments too.
Yep. But you might be able to craft your gem out of paper mache, make a mold of it, and then cast it in clear resin.
Which is what that is that I passed around. That's how that was done. A special dye too.
All right. Safety. Something a lot of people leave out of their lectures. There are safety hazards associated with resin. The vapors they give off are similar chemicals to superglue. They can cause respiratory problems in high concentrations. You can build up an allergy to it as well. You can also get contact allergies from getting it on your skin. So practice some basic safety procedures. The material safety data sheet is a form that is required by law that all manufacturers provide for chemicals they produce. Any of the good retailers will make that readily available and easy to find.
It's also online.
Yep. It will tell you what safety precautions are needed, what the hazards are, what to do for disposal. And from experience, they're usually pretty confusing.
Science.
Okay, for protection. First thing they recommend is adequate ventilation. The AC in your house is not ventilation. Ventilation is the air going outside. You cast in your house without taking the air out, and all you're doing is just letting the vapors collect in your home. So do it in either cast it outside, in the garage with the door open, put a box fan in a window, but make sure the air is leaving the area that you occupy. Respirators. Some of the resins are a lot more aggressive chemically than others, specifically the clear resins. They give off vapors more readily. They're a little bit more hazardous. You want to wear a respirator if you're going to be doing the clear resins.
This is not a respirator.
No, that is a
so you guys know,
that is a dust mask.
Yes, this is not a respirator.
And that might protect you against half the dust. This, and now I got the full face because if I'm casting, I don't want to accidentally splash resin in my eye and glue my eyeball to my eyelid. It's not going to come off, not without wearing off. What you want to look for is a filter rated for organic vapors. You can find some that are rated for pesticides, some for toxic dust, others are just a dust filter. You want one that says organic vapor. The filters that came with this are actually multi-use. They include organic vapors and a dust filtration. Dust filtration is a good thing if you're working with resin, because if you have to sand it, the sanding dust is similar to silica dust or asbestos when it gets in your lungs. It sits there and builds up scar tissue around it, and eventually you won't be able to breathe. So anytime you sand resin, wear at least a dust mask. Skin and eye protection. Like I said, you can build up a contact allergy.
Where would be the best place to try to find a respirator?
You can buy the half mask respirator, which is probably adequate for most people's use, at Home Depot. I think Lowe's might have them. I got mine online. That was about $100, but it's a good quality mask.
I paid $40 for mine. Yeah. It's only a half.
I think the MSA half mask I've seen as low as like 25.
Yes. And it's like power tools. You don't want to get a cheap respirator because it's not going to protect you. And just keep firmly in mind the image of glass in the lung, because that's what it is. Mm-hmm. So it's good to invest in a good respirator because you will use it. Yes, sir.
Yeah, when you use a respirator, I think for the guy, it'd be clean shaven. It makes a proper seal around your
yes.
face.
It helps. There's been some testing done that says a well-trimmed beard may be good enough. Like this, I don't have the problem of a beard, but it feels like it does seal fairly well. What you want to try is check to make sure it's actually filtering the air and you don't have leaks. Now, I'll show it real quick.
All right, once you've got your mask on, you want to be able to move your head, you don't want it digging in on the side. You want to cover the filters and breathe in. If you feel the mask sucking up against your face, you've got a good seal.
He said, you want to cover the filters. Just for those who couldn't hear the back, you want to cover the filters and breathe in to see if you actually get incoming air, just to make sure it's filtering correctly. So that you make sure that it's actually working as intended. If you do that and it does not have an air intake, then you either need to replace the cartridges or the entire mask. Because at that point, it's useless to you. It's not actually filtering.
You also want to place your hand over the air exhaust and breathe out. And you should feel the mask bulge out a little, and then it'll burp as the seal breaks from the pressure. That tells you that your exhalation valve is functioning properly and not just letting air pass both ways. Yes?
I have my hand mask, one of the ones with paint filters.
Check the rating on the filter. It should list what it protects against. And if it says OV, that's organic vapors.
Yes.
Okay. I have a gas mask actually from the military surplus store. If I do the breathing tests on it, it is actually rated for mustard gas.
That doesn't mean it's rated for organic vapors. I believe it's a chlorine based. That you want a specific organic vapor rating. Chances are it's a carbon filter, which is basically the same as this. But you may also have trouble finding the replacement filters. Because the military filters are only rated for about 24 hours exposed to air. That's another consideration. When you're done using your mask, take the filters off, put them in a sealed bag. They'll last a lot longer. They won't absorb moisture, whatever other chemicals in the air just sitting there, and they'll be useful. They say the newer filters are good for multiple shifts of work. For most of us, that's 10 minutes of casting, put it away for a week, 10 minutes. So it's going to last a long time, but you don't want them to go bad ahead of time.
Can we go ahead and skip to the casting?
Sure, no problem. For casting. Right. Well, actually, the safety is the important stuff.
Right.
You can find all this online. Most people won't do safety. Silicone RTV. It's a room temperature vulcanizing rubber, meaning it solidifies and turns into a rubber without heat. There's two basic types. There's the tin cure and the platinum cure. They both have their own specific uses. The tin cure is good for general casting use. It's probably about two-thirds the price of the platinum cure. It's easy to use. You can put it up, you can make a mold out of almost anything, but it is not rated for food use. Don't think about making a chocolate mold out of it. And it is not rated for skin contact. So you don't want to make a piece of armor that you're going to be wearing right next to your skin out of it. It's safe to handle it. There's some talk going around that tin cure RTV is toxic. A cured mold is not toxic. The catalyst, and generally they'll come in like a 10 to 1 ratio mix. The part that's 1 part to 10 is generally a fairly toxic chemical. Don't drink it. Don't pour it on your skin. Back. Wear gloves. Wear clothes that you can get off in case you spill the resin on you. Platinum cure resins, on the other hand, some of them are rated for food contact and skin contact, so you can make prosthetic pieces out of them. You can make a full face mask if you want. Silicone also has the advantage of, or not silicone, the platinum cure also has much lower shrinkage. So when you cast something, it's going to come out almost exactly the same size. With the tin cure, I've seen shrinkages of up to 3% listed. If it has to fit tightly into another piece, it might not. You also want to use a platinum cure if you're casting clear parts, because the tin cure gives off alcohol vapors that will mess with the finish of the clear part. Types of molds. Your basic mold is going to be a single piece mold, generally an open face mold like this. This is actually a hand grip from a paintball gun. Like I said about saving money, I can't find another one of this paintball gun's grip. So what I've got, and I might want to make multiple props with it, I could spend hundreds to try and find it. But single piece mold, I'll show the actual making of this mold in a little bit. basically you mount your piece you're copying on a flat surface, you put a mold box around it, and you pour the RTV over it. When you're done, you just pop the piece out of the mold. A glove mold would be what I would be using for this. I don't want any seam lines on it. So I'll use a fairly soft rubber and just leave a hole to pour the resin into. And then I'll literally peel it back off the part. A split mold is basically a single piece pour like the glove mold, only you make a cut in it so that you can take the part out without destroying the mold or the part. And yes, I've done both. Two-piece molds, instead of pouring it as a single block, generally you'll use modeling clay, and you want a sulfur-free modeling clay. You can generally find it, I believe the common brand is Clean Clay. The sulfur will interfere with the curing of the RTV. So you use clean clay, and you don't end up with a gooey mess for months. You will embed your part halfway into the clay, clean up the edges so that the clay comes right up to the edge of the part. The cleaner your edge, the less flashing or excess stuff oozing out on the edges you'll get on your mold. You can also pour a single piece block mold and cut it all the way through. And for that, say this is your mold. If you just cut straight through, when you put your mold back together, it's going to shift back and forth. So what you do is...
Do you want to do it on the webcam here so people can see it close?
Sure. All right, what you can do is you want to leave a registration key. So,
a little further down.
I'll let you aim it. Okay. If you make a wavy cut,
it's in front of the light.
Oh, okay.
Here. I'm holding it right here.
All right. Okay, I made a wavy shaped cut, and then once you get it, you aim the camera and up.
I'm trying to move the camera. It's just a little. I'm trying to do it little by little. So that...
All right, I made the first wavy cut, and then you can start to straighten it out. And I'll try not to slice my hand open because blood is a problem to clean up. All right, now, as you see, that mold has ridges in it that will lock together when you put it back together, when you put your mold back together. That way, you don't end up with a huge gap from one side to the other where and again, I've made this mistake. Two sides have, you want them to line up like this, and they end up like this. Not gonna look good.
There we go.
And a lot of all this material you can find online, there's dozens of YouTube videos. Most of the manufacturers have really good tutorial videos. This is just an overview, give you an idea of what to look for, because that's the biggest problem with prop making is knowing what you're searching for. All right. The final type of mold is a matrix or mother mold, and that's generally used for larger pieces to save you on materials. All right, mold design. Think about how the part is going to sit in the mold. Obviously, your open face mold is going to sit at the surface. But you're going to run into problems. Eventually, you're going to do something that your first try, you think it's going to come out beautifully, and there's bubbles in it because you couldn't get all the air out of the mold. Mold box. The simplest mold box is just like a cardboard tube, or my favorite, Lego blocks, because I can build the box to the exact dimensions of the part. You can also use foam core glued together with hot glue. You just need something to contain the RTV while it's curing, because it makes a mess, especially when your mold box leaks. Vents and gates, I'll show some pictures of that in a bit. That's basically, vents let air out of areas that you may or may not get bubbles. Gates are what you pour the resin into. Basically, it works as a funnel to get it into the mold and acts as an expansion volume in case there's bubbles. There's a good chance you do something complex. There's going to be air trapped in it. You're going to have to move the mold around. You could run out of resin. You could think it's full. The bubble comes out, and now you've got that much of your part missing because the resin ran into where the bubble was. Pouring the mold, I'll get to after the next slide.
1 minute.
1 minute?
Then I need to trade over to Steve.
All right. Go and flip through the slides. Okay, that's an open face mold. The white dot is a bubble. Next slide. Green line is just a slot in the mold for letting air out. Next. The light area would be a split mold where you peel part of it away. That would be an example of a glove mold for this. And this is going to have a bolt embedded in the casting. Next. Mother mold, say you're doing like something big like a pistol.
Thank you.
You'll do a two-piece mold, and you'll use a thinner layer of rubber for the mold, and then you'll put a hard backing on it.
Sorry, I had to reassemble my book.
And
see it?
Yeah, well, there's a couple pictures of that you can flip through.
Oh, there.
That's making this mold. There's a ring of blue tack around the bottom of the mold box to seal it. I brushed some RTV onto the part initially so that I didn't have any bubbles against the surface, and then pour it, and then your resources. And if we have time after him, I'll actually do a demo of a casting.
Okay, a lot of what we're going to see on the slides is also on the handout, so you can follow along that way. This next section is on lighting effects, and we'll start off with what I like to call the three C's: cash, cannibalize, and construct. Cash being, of course, if you're willing to pay the money, you can find something already made, already programmed, wired together, ready to just drop into a prop or a costume, but because somebody else did the labor and got the parts, you're going to pay for it. Okay? The next step down is to cannibalize. That is to take something that might be a little worn or missing a part that you can split apart and take the electronics out of. And then with just a little bit of work, adding a couple extra wires to a battery pack, put something together that you can then use. So you're cannibalizing from other parts. It's cheaper, but you do have to put a little bit of work into it. The C for construct is to take the raw materials, the basic components, and start from scratch putting it together. Now eventually, you're going to find that's the best way to go. You save the most money, and you get to do things the way you want them. You get your lights, the color you want, the location, the brightness, everything you want is exactly the way you want it, not the way somebody else envisioned it. And you can find that when you go on to some of the resources there on the handout, there are the cost of LEDs, wire, battery packs is really pretty small compared to what you pay for a fully made, already assembled kit. Now, when you're starting putting a lighting effect into something, you have to ask just what is it you want to produce. Do you want a soft glow, either daytime or nighttime glow? You may not need electricity, batteries, wires, or anything. You might be able to go with fluorescent paints, day glow paints, and painting on just a small piece onto something so that reflected light makes it look like it's being lighted. Or you might use glow paints. This is a latex base, glows in the dark, and you can build up several coats. And this has a nice green glow to it. It's really fun to paint this on a wall and have the kids stand in front of it and take pictures of themselves because it leaves the shadows behind. It's a lot of fun. There are also fabric paints that they don't glow as bright as the latex because they have the actual fabric paint base in them, but they're very easy to apply. I did a Tron costume, the original Bruce Boxleitner a few years ago, right onto a bodysuit with the tracings on, and every time somebody took a flash picture, that suit came alive. And it glowed for just a few seconds.
If you want to do a Tron suit.
Yeah. You want to spend a lot of time next to the brightest light fixture in the room and stay charged up. But it comes in several colors, and you can apply it directly out of the room. You may want a pinpoint dot or a flashing light, or perhaps something that's animated or in a sequence.
Like your shirt?
Yes, like this here. You also have the different color choices. There's different ways to color your light. You can use the LEDs or bulbs. Another source that is not electrical is chem light. Everybody's seen these chemical lights around Halloween time. Everybody, you see them in all the stores.
Glow sticks.
They call them glow sticks. Basically two chemicals that when they mix together fluoresce, there's a little glass bulb inside, and you just put it together, and it starts glowing. It's a very nice effect, a nice even glow. Do not believe what it says on the container. If it says 8 hours lighting, no, that's not the way it goes. 8 hours means at the end of 8 hours in a dark room, you could find this thing somewhere. Actually, they lose about 50% of their light every half hour. So if you're expecting this brightness, you'll need to change out the light stick every now and then. Okay, but they're pretty inexpensive. When you design your prop, make sure you give it access so you don't have to take something apart in order to change out the stick. You don't want to spend half your convention disassembling a prop, okay? A case in point of that is this Buck Rogers blaster that I made a few years ago. It has a big vacuum tube in it, and I wanted the vacuum tube to look like it was energized. So I needed kind of just a soft orange glow. So when I designed it, this brass plate in the bottom is actually built with a bend in it, a V-bend, that makes a trough underneath the tube. I don't know if you can see that. You can see that there. There's kind of a little space underneath there. And that's the place that I'm able to put a glow stick. Okay. So I don't need batteries, I don't need anything like that. It's going to be a really old one. Yeah, it's not going to like it. But I'm able to just slide in the glow stick, and now I have a soft orange glow along the tube without using batteries, LEDs, or anything like that. And I can pry it back out and swap it out whenever I need to. Okay. So that's just the way you plan your prop in order to have access to the component. A very quick way to provide lighting is just to put a colored gel or filter over a flashlight. And you get LED flashlights everywhere for a buck or two. And the simplest way is just to put a about a quarter size piece of colored plastic over it. It's optically clear but colored to provide the filtering for it. Now, what kind of resource would you have for those? Well, right to start out, vitamin bottles, plastic caps. This is from a deodorant stick, I think. But here I have red, orange, and green. And all you do is cut just a small piece out and tape it to the end of the flashlight. And you see you get a nice filtered color, nice bright floodlight. And you can fit that in just about anywhere.
If you're needing a very, very specific color,
mm-hmm.
or something like that, you can probably go on to any theatrical lighting website and find and get some center books of the theatrical gels, and they have very specific colors you can get. I have 10 bazillion of the little swatch books, and I get them those other different websites.
Also, places that deal in stained glass materials, if they teach classes, they probably have a scrap box that they sell for just so much a pound, and you can get small bits of optically clear glass that are easy to shape down and just electrical tape them to the end of the light, and there's just the whole rainbow of colors there.
You can use Mylar too.
Mm-hmm.
Mylar sheets.
Another source is like cannibalized toys, like this one here. Unfortunately, it has an obnoxious sound effect. But you can cut the speaker away. But you can see this is held together with small screws, and if I was to take this apart, I would have all kinds of circuitry in there. There's several places that have LEDs and lights and things. And you can incorporate these into a wizard staff or another type of a prop, anywhere you want to use the light. It's got the battery pack in it, the lighting. You might find this at a little toy store or Goodwill or something where it's a little scraped up dent, a little piece broken off, get it for a buck. But the lighting inside works just fine, so you cannibalize it.
So those who want to do Naruto's Rasengan, that.
Yeah. Another source is toys, pins, and party favors. You go to a convention, they have little promotional things, little pens and things that blink. They have things that sequence little lights. This is a Halloween safety light. And after I pry it off the jack-o'-lantern front, you have a nice little circuit board. You have rings. There's body jewelry that has the little magnets on it. One of the references on the handout sheet is Windy City Novelties and BlinkyThings.com. They have hundreds and hundreds of things that will flash and strobe and sequence any color you want. If you want a single color, if you want it to wash back and forth between colors, jump back and forth. I have some that do blue to red. Makes great cop stuff. It looks like a little police vehicle. It's blue, red, like this. And like the size of a dime. Fantastic.
Please don't let it.
Now moving on to my actual favorite, the semiconductor LED. Well, when these are invented, man, we had the red, yellow, green, and then eventually the blue and the white. LEDs can provide incredible light, lots of colors, and they're pretty easy to work with, really. You can see here, I have the entire spectrum with just two batteries. Now on your handout there, it does mention using three batteries with the blue and the white. That's because the red, orange, yellow, and green require at least 2 volts to fire. So 2 1.5 volt batteries give you 3 volts, you've got what you need. The blue and the white actually require about 3.2 volts to operate. The reason you can see them here is that these are brand new batteries, and they put out about 1.6 when they're fresh. If I was to leave this running for a while, you see, when you see the white is already starting to dim out a little bit, it's not as bright as the others. Eventually, the blue and the white would go out as the batteries start to dim down. They need at least 3.2 volts to operate. Now, when working with an LED, you also have to have a current limiting resistor. An LED is like a switch. It has power in, power out. And if you give it a whole battery to work with, it'll try and take the whole battery. And it'll light like crazy for about 1 second. And then it dies. So by putting a current limiting resistor in there, you're slowing down and limiting what goes into the LED. Now, as it turns out, when you do the mathematics of it, whether you're working with the 2-volt LEDs or the 3-volt, a 33-ohm resistor works just fine for either one. So if you're going to order some components, LEDs, wire, battery packs, just get a little package of 33-ohm resistors. And they can be anywhere in the circuit, on the positive or the negative side. It doesn't matter. As long as that resistor's in there, you'll keep from burning that LED out, and you'll take it just to about its maximum brightness without overloading it. Let's see. there's a particular kit that I work with quite a bit, and it's a circuit control LED. This is a module, very inexpensive, cost about $5. You get it at Hobby Lobby or at a place called Shrunk's. It's a big craft catalog up in Ohio. And this contains battery pack, circuit board, and five pairs of LEDs. And those pairs cycle, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you get them two at a time then. Now, depending on how you place those LEDs, you can get kind of a random looking pattern or a chasing sequence. You just have to put them in order. The LEDs you don't want to use, you can just cut away. Now, these come in two types. One is this diffused with the red, yellow, and green like you see here. And the other is the clear with this yellow strobing. So there's a lot you can do with these. Kind of an ultimate project is a jacket here I did. It's a Battlestar Galactica jacket with a battle scene on it. I used two of the kits, pretty much unmodified, although I did cut some of the LEDs off and change them out for orange. But this one uses two of the kits, and it's sequenced to show kind of the straight line to show the gunfire, and then down here kind of a random with the explosion. Okay. And because they have a 1 foot wire going to each LED, all you do is make a little hole with a finishing nail, with a cloth, shove the LED in, and it's got they come with little O-rings to put over them to hold them in place. You can take them out, launder the garment, put the lights back in. Very easy to work with.
$5 kit.
This is what they look like in the store. They call them fashion lights. Comes with batteries too. There's everything you need for about $5. Now going a little bit farther, yes.
Where would you use a
fashion light? I have seen them at Hobby Lobby, sometimes Michael's. I got these online at Shrunk's, which is a place in Ohio, and I bought like a case of them because I use so many of them. Yeah. But Hobby Lobby, I know they carry them. Yeah. Over in the section where you have the clothing, because they're designed originally for clothing, but you can use them for a lot of things. Now, if you decide to go with making a kit and go ahead and add a little more skill to your repertoire and learn how to solder, you can find dozens of kits that sequence the lights and animate them for you. And they don't have that many components. This kit here has about 8 or 10 little components to it. So if you're doing something like a Ghostbusters backpack or you have a weapon or something that looks like it needs a moving display, there are just dozens of different patterns. Just put the components in. You can also do custom circuit boards, eventually etching your own board and getting a design off the internet. This jacket here, down here, the Cylon I that you see going back and forth, that's about a quarter size circuit board design I got off the internet. Although you can find these kits now, they're already ready to go. You just push the components in, solder them, and you get the back and forth chasing effect.
I had a roommate who made custom glow sticks using printed circuit boards, so you could reprogram them and do whatever pattern you wanted. It's totally worth learning how to do.
Now another type of electronic device you can use is called L-wire, EL standing for electroluminescent. It has a transformer, a battery pack, and it works because the wire is an inner and outer casing. And when high voltages run through it, that static electricity runs through there and causes the inner wall to fluoresce. These come self-contained. The good thing about them is they're flexible. You can run the wire anywhere you want. You can wrap it around things to make it brighter. Yes? Yeah, there's also e-ribbon. Yeah, there's e-ribbon. Yeah. You can get ribbon and there's plates. But I find the wire works nice because you can either take it out very long or wrap it around something several times to add brightness to it. The downside is it's not very bright. You know, nowhere near as bright as the LEDs, but it does give you the flexibility. Okay. Now the modules that come with this also have a nice feature. They have the circuitry built in to strobe them like a neon light. So you don't have to add any extra circuitry. If you don't want a continuous glow and just want a pulsing like a neon light, they have a little place in there, you just push the button and it just switches and begins to pulse. So that's also part of it.
Would you be able to mess with the frequency of how it pulses, like it starts off slow and speeds up?
Now the ones I've seen here are completely contained because this is kind of a high voltage in here. And you really don't want to be messing with the circuitry because there's a transformer in there, and even though it's only 3 volts, it jacks it up pretty high.
Okay.
And I think also converts it to an AC. So you touch it, you're gonna get it.
Some inverters do have multiple modes where you can change how fast it blinks, but if you wanted something more than that, you basically have to make your own.
In the sites that you find that, they'll usually tell you like if it has, how many settings it has,
yes,
whether it will go slow or fast.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Now, as far as a circuit design using any of the components here, a few rules of thumb. Keeping access to your power supply so you can swap out batteries, like it was with the light sticks. If you can't get to the battery, you're going to spend a lot of time taking things apart. So try and find a way to work it into the design where it doesn't look like a battery pack, but yet you have access to it. See, this is something I did. This has some tubes in it, and I wanted the tubes to look like they would get powered up. So they have orange LEDs inside. The battery pack for that is sitting right here. It's just painted to look like everything else. So I just take a screw out, pull it back, and I can change out the batteries. Okay, easy to get to. No rootless assembly required.
What do you have in the bottom there that's making it flicker? Is it rotating?
No, this is this was a custom circuit I made that just has a timing chip, one of the simplest chips. It's only a little 8 pins to it, and it builds up a charge and then pulses it, builds it out, pulses it, and just dial up whether you want 1 per second, 10 per second, or 100 per second. And I just, the board's about the size of a quarter, and I just stuck it in there. That's the fun of learning how to solder, because it just opens up so many of the things to do with these kits and also custom design.
There are now kits where they teach you to solder. They're about $20-$30. And they give you all the components, they give you a soldering gun, a soldering tool, and you just go.
One other thing that's important is to mind your pluses and minuses. LEDs are a diode. If I was to accidentally reverse the wires, the LEDs just wouldn't work. Not a problem. But when you're working with the smaller circuits, transistors, and other types of integrated circuits, if you accidentally swap in plus and minus, you'll probably blow out the chip. And then you're gonna have a hard time finding the part. So always be mindful of where the positive and the negative wire is. I use color coding quite a bit. In the normal nomenclature, the black wire is always the common or negative. And then I will use wires of different colors. Say if I'm running LEDs somewhere, I'll use either a red, orange, yellow, green, or blue wire to indicate the positive wire to that LED. So if I have to trace it, I can say, well, I'm looking for the blue LED, it's the blue wire. Makes it a lot easier than to have a whole bunch of red wires and one black one and then sit there and figure out which one of those reds goes to the light you wanted. So color coding can work. Let's talk a little bit about connections. The simplest wire connection you can have is just to twist two wires together. It works. Wrap a little tape on it. Probably it's just not very strong. And if there's going to be any tension or any movement in your part, it's probably going to come undone. So you want to make a better connection. The next best way is to use what's called a wire nut or wire acorn. These have a little spring inside, and as you twist them onto the wires, it grabs and engages all the wire filaments, and it's very, very strong. If you were to pull down a ceiling fan in your house and look up inside the box, you'd find bigger versions of these handling the big power wires in your house. The downside is that they're bulky. If you're trying to run a wire somewhere, you have to have a hole big enough for this thing to pass through. Okay, but they are very fast. Really the best way to connect a wire is to go ahead and solder it. And soldering is twisting the wires together, melting the solder onto that wire bundle, and then letting it harden, and it is as hard as the wire itself or harder. You then cover it with what's called shrink tubing. It's the same type of material you find on Easter baskets where it pulls real tight when you heat it up. The tubing goes over, you heat it with a lighter for a second or two, and it pulls down tight, completely seals the joint, makes it waterproof, and as you can see, it's thin. If I had a very slender hole, I could pass this wire and the connection through that hole. So it just takes a little bit more time. Soldering is not that difficult. And if you look on your handout, to the right is a little graphic that shows soldering fundamentals. It's a picture of a soldering iron tip coming down to solder a part. Okay. I have on there, there are four steps. Heat, solder, solder, heat. Okay. It's a simple procedure. You notice the tip of the soldering iron is kind of shaped at a 90 degree angle. That's because it heats the wire that's coming through the circuit board and the copper on the circuit board at the same time. And it forms a 90 degree angle. So the tip comes in and heats both those simultaneously to the same temperature. So when you add your thread of solder to it, the solder will flow evenly across both the wire component and the soldering and the circuit board. So what you do is you add the heat, heat it to a temperature that will melt solder, you add the string of solder and it flows around, you pull the solder away, then you pull the heat away, and you allow the little bubble of solder to harden. So it's apply heat, apply solder, remove solder, remove heat. There's a little bit of artwork to that too. If you add the solder a little too fast, it may blob over to another connection on your circuit board and create a short circuit. If you put it in too slow, it may not flow evenly and create kind of a donut around the wire, and you'll think you've got a good connection, but it's actually insulated because it made a ring rather than flowing up onto the wire. So there's that kind of a middle ground, and it gives you a lot of tolerance, where you add heat, add solder, pull the excess solder away, pull away the heat. And once you pick that up as a skill, you'll find all these different kits, all kind of fantastic things can be made very quickly. A kit like this you could do in less than a couple hours. Okay. Now as far as some parts resources, I do a lot of things where I buy parts from Electronic Gold Mine. It's kind of a surplus place, they have great prices. All Electronics is another one. If you don't mind paying a little bit more money and need something right away, Radio Shack, and there's a Radio Shack, you know, just about every street corner. Toy stores to get things cannibalized, and also party supply stores. Things like this little blinky light here, this, all these type of things can be found usually in like a bag of half a dozen or so as party favors. One final little piece. This is another thing about LEDs is that they have a lens on them, so they can throw light in a very particular small area, very concentrated. But because they're made of a clear rosin, you can cut that lens off and then polish them back to clear, and now you get more of a floodlight. So instead of a pinpoint of light, you can get something that spreads out more. So you can see here, I get more of a flooding effect than it would little points of light. The LED is only an eighth of an inch away from this, and yet it spreads out in a much wider line. Okay, we got a few minutes for questions. I'm going to turn it back over to Amber, and we'll be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Does anybody have any particular questions for us on anything? I saw one hand. Yes, sir.
On that nerf gun, looks like a nerf gun, right?
Yes.
Where is the battery?
I pulled the slide off, and since I took out the firing mechanism that was inside, all the moving parts in there, that gave me a cavity to fit in one of these little battery packs here. That's the one I use, are AAAs. They're smaller. These are double A's. It's really easy. The thing has, see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 7 screws. And you take the 7 screws and it splits like a clamp. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, then I use the push on, push off switch. So I can just, like this. And that's the kind of switch you can get at all Electronics, these kind of places. They have hundreds and hundreds of switches. Okay. Yes?
How long would you say the battery on the C wire lasts?
This? This one uses 2 double A's. There are versions that use a 9 volt, and the wire will be like 6 or 8 feet long. It just depends on how much wire is there. If you have just 3 feet like this one, you get a few hours use out of it. But if you run one of the 20 footers, you need a 9 volt. Yeah. But you can also double up. Battery packs can be soldered together in parallel. So you have 3 packs going to the positive wire and 3 going to the negative, and that puts 6 batteries to work instead of 2.
That makes sense.
a lot longer. Yes. Oh. Yeah, you notice the LED has the dome on it, that molded in lens. If you just cut that off flat and then sand it with 400 grit sandpaper and then a buffing wheel, you can bring it back to clear. And then instead of the concentrating lens that brings it down to a 15 degree angle, you get this 160 degree. So you can make floodlights out of an LED as opposed to a spotlight. Get close to the next one.
Guys, we can't hear. Can you put the wire between the LED roof? Wire?
Okay, you're talking about the 5 meter long, or this one right here? Yeah. Yeah, you can cut this off as long as you make sure that the inner and outer aren't touching each other when you get done. So you can cut it to length and then just put a dab of epoxy over it to prevent the outer from touching, and then you'll get the same, you get the fluorescent effect all the way across.
Guys, we are unfortunately out of time. If you would like to see this presentation, Lane's presentation, the handout, anything else related to this, including the video, please remember this address. It is cospod.org. That's C as in Charlie, O as in Oscar, S as in Sierra, P as in Papa, O as in Oscar, D as in Delta.
cospod.org.
We'll have everything on that website, including other ACON videos from cosplay panels and the cosplay contest. You guys can always ask us questions there as well. Thank you for coming.